Welcome back to Softcore History. I'm your host for the week, Dan Register, and I'm joined, as always, by Jake Goldman and Rob Fox. What is up, boys?
Hello, hello.
I went to a concert yesterday.
You were in the pit.
I was in the pit.
You're trying moshing. To love someone.
I was not trying to love anyone. I was trying to love myself.
Were you?
Was your wife not there?
No, I went with my buddy.
Okay.
Yeah. Why didn't you love your buddy then?
Yeah.
I loved my buddy.
Okay.
Me buddy loved.
Kiss or?
No, we didn't kiss. We just jumped up and down a lot.
You know what I hate about mosh pit culture?
What, that you get beat up every time you get in one?
No, close.
Because you're soft hands, yeah.
Close. Yeah, I sit in the balcony. Yeah. In the opera.
Sounds like the opera.
Yeah.
The opera seats.
He goes full Lincoln.
But no, I have like friends, not like friends, but like people I'm friends with on Facebook, a couple people who are like metalheads or whatever, and they'll always be like, "This people don't understand about the mosh pits, man. It's not violent."
They're really not.
As soon as you get knocked down, 100 people help you back up, and it's just time to keep going. I'm like, I don't know. You still got knocked down.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's not a Travis Scott concert.
Yeah.
Now, that is
they're
what a mosh pit should
you.
Be. Yeah,
that's
they're
the
soft.
Most metal. Yeah. If you don't have risk of trampling,
yeah,
what are you even doing?
Jake actually said it was gotten pretty soft.
Well, yeah, like when I was younger, people were throwing punches in the mosh pit.
They don't do that anymore, huh?
No, they don't do that no more.
If I was one of those dads whose son was killed at that Travis Scott concert by being crushed to death,
mm-hmm.
I would wait to see how my lawsuit went. And if it didn't go the way I wanted to, I'd probably murder him.
Kill Travis Scott?
Yeah.
Good luck getting to him.
What do you mean getting to him?
Get to Travis Scott. You couldn't.
I don't think it'd be hard.
I don't think you'd get close enough to shoot him.
Dude, he's protected by Ronald McDonald.
Yeah.
Cactus Jack? The Cactus Jack meal.
Yeah.
Phone call.
Well, yeah. One,
you don't just off somebody with McDonald's money.
I don't think you would be able to get close enough to Cactus Jack with a gun to be able to kill him. Especially.
How close do I need to get?
I mean, how good of a shot are you?
I'm a pretty really decent shot.
Are you?
I can get him in the
on
back.
A moving
I,
target?
I can get him in the spine.
You could shoot him in the spine
I, aiming
while
down
he's a, moving.
Aiming down a sidewalk so he's walking either away or towards me and not left to right.
It's very specific conditions. And there's a clear shot on him.
Clear
there's
enough.
No, it's down a sidewalk.
Clear enough.
You are on an empty sidewalk with Travis Scott.
He's too high on the totem pole. You have to go for like a lower rapper.
You,
like
yeah,
Young
I was
Dolph.
About to say, yeah.
Why would I kill Young Dolph, who's already dead, I think.
He is
but
dead.
He is
yeah,
dead.
He got shot at his cookie shop.
Kill some fucking mixtape rapper.
His favorite cookie
mixtape,
shop in Memphis.
Mixtape rapper didn't
kill
my kid.
Oh, how dare you? Fuck you, dude. Young Dolph was the GOAT.
I don't.
He wasn't the GOAT.
Never heard of him.
He wasn't the GOAT, but he also wasn't a fucking mixtape rapper.
No, he wasn't. He's,
oh, whatever.
He was very much a
have some respect
a noted
on
rapper.
Adolf, man.
Yeah, very much a noted rapper. We're a history show, by the way. But yeah.
Again, I'm connected.
Well,
everything.
He's history, so.
Yeah. Adolf.
Young Dolph, Adolf.
Young Dolph.
Yeah.
Not a lot of people with the name Dolph anymore.
No.
Dolph Lundgren.
And Dolph Young. Hitler.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think actually the Germans would have succeeded and he would have been beloved if he went by Dolph.
Mm.
Dolph is a hard ass name. That's a cool name.
The Germans win the war if he was Dolph.
Yeah, if he's yeah. Dolph Hitler.
Dolph Hitler.
He's 80.
Addy.
Addy. Yeah.
Addy Hitler.
Addy soft.
Yeah.
Dolph, though?
Or Dolph like, Hitler? That's terrifying.
Yeah.
Dolph takes England.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dolph takes Russia, dude.
Operation Sea Lion goes off without a hitch.
Yeah.
If his name is Dolph.
We have a Patreon, patreon.com/softcorehistory. You get two additional episodes every week. And, you know, we got about 2 years now of evergreen content. So I believe the last time I looked at it, we have like 300 posts or something.
On Patreon?
Mm-hmm.
Jeez.
What?
Yeah.
I guess we do a lot of Patreon
so
shit.
We've got almost a year's worth of Patreon.
You get
content.
Your fucking money's worth.
Yeah.
Yeah, you could listen every day for a year.
Yeah.
Just about.
There's some other stuff that you can read. We've done some things
oh, yeah,
that weren't
true, yeah.
specifically just episodes. And, of course, our last episode on Patreon was us playing Risk.
Yeah, the first part, I, for one, you know, we haven't finished the game yet, technically. It's going to be at least a two-parter. Probably
a lot of raving reviews, actually, so far. People didn't expect to like it as much as they did.
The Risk episode?
Yeah.
I need to listen to it, actually, but I will say the second
episode.
Guys
being dudes playing board games.
Second
episode, Rob getting upset.
Yeah, Rob is such a fucking titty baby the entire time.
Yeah.
Why am I not winning? Me.
You all teamed up on me from the jump.
Yeah, if you want,
there's three of us. It doesn't matter. No, it's not a spoiler. It's just we fucking nuke Rob. Don't worry. We just go on his neck.
We
it's
all,
very exciting because Rob gets progressively more upset.
He gets
as the
so
goes
upset.
On.
He gets
so
mad.
Patreon.com/softwarehistory.
Why didn't you make any alliances?
I tried to ally with you.
You didn't pitch it very hard.
You're whatever. You're going to get BF'd by both of them.
I'm not going to get BF'd by anybody. I'm going to butt-fuck the world.
No.
Anyway.
We just got demonetized.
On to today's episode. We get demonetized now every episode, and I have to like ask for a manual review on YouTube. It's very annoying. And it always gets approved. It's just
probably because with the end of our end of the award, end of the episode awards.
yeah.
I don't know. I don't think the AI goes that back that far. Probably it's like true. The first 5 minutes or something.
Yeah, they got better.
Well, we talked about them on the top.
Yeah, we talked about Dolph from the get-go.
So we're just covering our bases.
Yeah.
No, today we're going to talk about a man that we actually brought up last episode.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We were wrong.
What? I thought he was the...
We'll get to it.
Okay.
Today we're talking about John Quincy Adams.
So you're telling me I lied?
Yeah.
Again?
Yeah.
How come you keep clipping stuff of me lying?
It just does so well.
Yeah. Why does me lying always
gets everyone angry?
Algorithm?
Yeah. The wronger we are in clips, the angrier people get, the more engagement the post gets, the further it gets. If you want to know how lies get halfway around the world before the truth puts its pants on, now it's just the algorithm.
You were also so adamant. You're like, that's just facts. And it's like, actually, check it out. It's not.
Which is...
We'll get to it.
Am I on the wrong...
We'll get to it. Okay. We'll get to it. Okay. Don't spoil it.
I'm baffled that I'm wrong. Which I shouldn't be. I should not be baffled by that.
So before we get into this episode, do you guys know much about Quincy? Clearly, Jake does not.
I know nothing about him then.
Rob?
You just
know that the guy from The Bear played him in...
Son of John Adams and, yeah, hilariously, the cousin or quote cousin from The Bear played him. I like knew, that's how I knew the actor first, so watching him in The Bear is really funny.
Did he actually get to the North Pole? Did he get us to the North Pole at least?
Just wait. God damn, you're like my kids on Christmas Eve. Just go to bed.
Okay.
Yeah, why don't you take a little nap?
All right.
Me and Rob got this.
All right. Have fun. All right.
So, John Quincy, born July 11th, 1767 on the family farm in Braintree, Massachusetts. He was the second child and first son of John and Abigail Adams. Obviously, his father was a framer of the Constitution, one of the biggest names during the Revolution. But the Adams were, compared to the rest of the founding fathers, not particularly wealthy.
Fairly middle class. Mm-hmm. John was a lawyer of repute, but, you know, yeah, upper middle class. They had a home in Boston, and then they had the farm, wherever that was that you just said. So, you know, multiple properties and stuff like that. But, like, yeah, not like, we're not talking like Washington, Jefferson, who were like fucking loaded.
Well, the name of the town now is called Quincy, I believe.
Okay.
So they renamed it after our guy.
That's
here.
Yeah.
Quincy at 7 watched the Battle of Bunker Hill with his mother from a distance.
Hmm. That's awesome. People don't get to do that anymore.
No.
Now they call it stuff like school shootings.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And
I miss the days
drive-bys.
When you could just stand on your front porch, maybe lean on a pole.
And watch a war?
Watch a what? Battle, yeah.
A battle.
Yeah.
That's what they took. That's what they want to take from you.
Well, you know, now if you're anywhere near a battle, you're getting just murked by a drone.
Yeah, true.
It's like,
dying in battle is probably lame as shit now.
It's like... Like a drone just hits you. It's like, oh, and you're done.
It's like dying in Call of Duty now.
Some fucking, like, purple-haired gamer is just, like, in a fucking... Not even, like, doesn't even make a noise. They just, like, eat a fucking Cheeto, and then, like, as you just, like, lay bleeding out from the grenade they drop from a drone.
Now, do you think they will program the robots to teabag us after they kill us?
Yeah.
Yes.
1,000%.
That's all I ask.
Look at that. Look at this fucking cuck.
I've watched a lot of grenade videos from the Russia-Ukraine war.
Mm-hmm.
So,
they still teabag in video games to this day.
Quincy, in mid-February 1778, at 10, accompanied his father on a transatlantic voyage to France.
Yeah, that was when... All of my knowledge of John Adams is from the show, John Adams, I'll be totally honest with you. But that was when John Adams and I think Benjamin Franklin were trying to convince France to either get in the war or just give more to the war.
Yeah.
And... So, yeah, Quincy was in roughly the vicinity of Ben Franklin when he was on his fuck trip. One of his many fuck trips.
He's a middle-class guy, but he's on a transatlantic voyage to France.
It's government paid.
Oh, okay.
We give Benny Franklin a little too much credit.
Mm.
He was kind of a scumbag. He was mostly a scumbag.
He just fucked.
It wasn't that, dude. He was just... I'm pretty sure the idea of him with the key and the kite, he bought that idea from somebody. He stole the IP. Or he didn't steal it, but he bought the IP.
If he paid for it, then who cares?
Then it's paid for. He could have just stolen it.
But he was essentially your friend that was the idea guy.
Yeah, cool. Need one of those
guys. Useful guy.
I like idea people.
Sort of.
I mean, you need an execution guy. You need a do the work guy.
That's why I never ran for anything.
I know.
Well, like in the American government.
The founding fathers in general were a good mix of, it was a good mixed bag, right? Like Adams was a grinder.
Yeah.
Washington was like the figurehead leader you needed. Jefferson was the brains, but also had a bit of an ego.
Mm-hmm. But Jefferson was the artist. He was the lead singer
mm-hmm.
in a lot of ways. Actually, he wasn't a lead singer. He was more like
the lead guitarist.
Yeah, it was like Eddie Van Halen or something.
Yeah.
And actually, Quincy's the first non-founding father that became president.
Okay.
As number six.
Interesting.
Because it was, what, Madison, then Monroe?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
He attended private boarding school in Paris, where he studied Latin and French, and ultimately became fluent or passable in seven different languages.
People used to be useful.
So Quincy's kind of the first American that is a world traveler.
First person born in America that travels the world, mm-hmm. I guess, yeah. Because like, if otherwise, being in America by default makes you a world traveler if you're not born there.
He gets all over, especially in his childhood and adolescence.
Yeah, I mean.
Because of his dad, yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Did he go, I assume, wait, did he go with him to like the Netherlands and shit too?
Mm-hmm.
And yeah.
So when does he first encounter?
We'll get to that.
When does he first encounter a mole person?
So, man. Just let it marinate.
I don't expect
let the story play out.
I don't expect you to answer them, but I'm gonna ask.
You're like my mom watching a movie.
Who is that? Did they die at the end?
It's like we're watching the same movie. I have no idea. It's the same linear story.
But here's the thing: we're not watching the same movie. You have the script and wrote it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just a passive viewer.
You're talking to the television. What happens next, television?
Right, but we're 5 minutes in and you're asking Christopher Nolan, what's the end of Memento?
Well, it's the middle.
Mm-hmm.
That's the end.
Yeah, because the middle is where I get to the mole people.
Ah, yes. Okay, perfect.
There you go. At the influence of his father, Quincy began a diary while in Europe and continued it for the rest of his life. So 70 plus years of just Quincy's
thoughts
and just his hopes and dreams.
Dear diary, my father's friend Benjamin keeps knocking at my door late at night. He keeps begging me to find wine and wants to know if I want dibs on any of the broads.
I don't know. But they're all so old.
Yeah.
This is why we know so much about the Adams, is because both John and Quincy kept a diary that was pretty lengthy.
Miss me with keeping a diary.
But that's the key to, if you really want to like...
Preserve yourself in history.
That, and also make sure that your narrative is the one that gets told.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
Give them more details.
Yeah.
Right. You're making the historian's job easier. Yeah.
What if I just wrote, like, I'm going to just write a ridiculously fake diary. And just leave it in a time capsule.
You should.
And people will be like,
who was this Jake Goldman?
This guy.
This guy's a fucking lunatic.
Also, well, they're like 600 years from now, they're like, whoa, people in like the 2010s really like were doing some weird shit.
Yeah.
You know, just like make up some sort of like social construct that didn't actually exist.
Yeah, completely.
Yeah.
In fact, if I had a time machine or like got sucked through a wormhole back to any point in time where there was like recorded history, I would just write down the most, absolutely insane shit. Yeah. I'd be like, hey, like if I got sucked back to ancient Sumeria, I'd be like, dear diary, this place is even crazier than I thought. I killed 5 dragons today because I'm very strong. There are dragons everywhere.
You have to.
Yeah.
You have to.
If you go back in time, there's no reason to not fuck with the future self.
Absolutely.
No, it has to.
He does have quite a high opinion of himself. In fact, he once called his diary some of the most precious and valuable works written by human hands.
Wow, that's a fucking claim.
I love it.
That's such a shithead thing to say.
Good for him.
Good for him, why?
He's incredibly self-important.
What year did he write that specifically?
When did he say that?
Yeah.
I think it was in his later years.
Okay.
It wasn't like, not when he's a kid.
That'd be sicker.
If he was like 12.
It'd be insane. I don't know which is worse, saying it when you're like 14 or saying it when you're 84.
By the way, another excellent person who portrayed, this reminded me because it's old John Quincy, who portrayed John Quincy Adams. Probably my favorite part of the movie Amistad is Anthony Hopkins plays old as fuck John Quincy Adams.
We'll get to that.
Okay. Yeah.
You think I just breezed over the Amistad?
No, I don't know. I don't know what you did.
I don't even know what that is.
You never saw the movie Amistad?
No, I don't even know. I've never even heard of it.
Okay.
It's a good movie. People, other lab, it kind of got like...
It's also a pretty major historical event.
The Amistad?
Mm-hmm.
What the
we'll get to it.
Okay.
But like, that movie got...
God damn it.
That movie's been getting a lot of blowback lately. Not lately, but like in the peak like woke era because people were like, oh, it's a white savior movie or whatever. I liked the movie.
But he literally was a white savior.
Yeah, they needed a white guy to save him.
No,
they
needed Quincy did this.
Like, yeah, I know. They needed a white guy to save him. Now, to be fair, they needed a white guy to save them from other white guys. So it's not like white people, fuck yeah. It's more just a break even. But I don't know. It's a good movie. I liked it.
And also how he gets them off might be a little different than maybe how the movie portrays.
I'm sure.
So they sail back to the U.S. in 1779 and arrive back in August. It was very short-lived, though, as they immediately turned back 2 months later to France, as Big John had to negotiate a peace treaty with Britain to recognize America's independence.
They had to go back 2 months later?
Mm-hmm.
So, what, they spent like fucking 3 weeks on the boat, got there, 2 months of rest. I mean, that, at this point, that's like...
It's hell.
That's a nightmare. That's like having a flight, like a six-hour flight, getting to the airport, getting to sleep for like... 6 hours, I guess, at the airport, and then getting right back on the fucking plane for another 6 hours.
Well, this particular trip was not so smooth. Obviously, the war was going on. They had dodge some British ships. A lot of storms.
While they were negotiating?
Well, this was in 1779, so it was like the early stages of, get to the table. It wasn't like full-on
negotiations.
Yeah, the war
didn't end for another couple of years.
Yeah, so they had to at least, get the framework going. However, on this trip, the ship took damage. It began to take on water, forcing the captain to make landfall in northern Spain in early December, and the group had to cross the Pyrenees Mountains into France. They arrived back into Paris in February 1780. So a bit of a detour.
Yeah, no shit.
I can't imagine any road trip at that time is fun.
Can you imagine, there was an issue with the wing of the plane, so we know you wanted to go to Paris, but you're in Lisbon now. And we can't get you there.
Also, your boat's starting to sink in December.
Yeah. Ooh.
Cold water.
You're going to die soon.
It's like, please find the nearest place, like piece of land.
Anywhere.
Yeah.
That isn't a fucking jagged cliff. Just put the boat there.
Yeah.
French foreign minister wouldn't come to an agreement with Adams until the French would reconquer Canadian territories taken by the British.
They wanted revenge for that little world war they were just in, the Seven Years' War. I mean, the whole revolution happened because of the Seven Years' War.
Big John had to call an audible, so he went to Amsterdam to get a loan from the Dutch and to lessen American dependence on the French.
That's a funny scene from John Adams, because the Dutch are just like these stiff like Puritans, and they're all speaking Dutch like about him in front of him, and they're just like, this guy sucks. About John Adams, not Quincy. Like, this guy's, what the fuck's going on?
Quincy's like a teen here.
Yeah.
While he was in Amsterdam, though, he enrolled at the University of Leiden. He impressed many, including one of the men that accompanied his father, Francis Dana. When Dana was appointed minister of the court to Catherine the Great in St. Petersburg in 1781, he took 14-year-old Quincy to be both his secretary and interpreter.
So wait, he was in the court of Catherine the Great?
At 14.
That's insane.
What a life. That's insane. Lord, that's sick already.
And
also
haven't even, like...
We haven't even gotten
to the top of the iceberg. There's so much more.
Yeah. And by the way, I was about to say something stupid. It might be true, but I think it's stupid. I was about to be like, wow, and he spoke Russian, but I think they spoke French in the court, and that's why he was the interpreter in the court of Catherine the Great.
No, he spoke Prussian and Russian. He learned all these different languages. Again, he spoke seven languages.
I know, but I'm pretty sure they spoke French in court.
Okay.
So, but who knows? The reason it's called lingua franca is because French used to be English.
Okay.
Everyone used to speak French for business and blah, blah, blah.
That was America, or the world's English?
Yeah. That's now insane. It's English. Now English is the lingua franca.
The lingua ingla.
But we need to change it. Fuck lingua franca. It needs to be like, speak English.
Speak American.
Yeah. The English can't even speak English well.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. English, we need to go from lingua franca to like the shit you speak. Just the dumbest English way to say it.
Talk possible. Normal.
Yeah.
Talk normal.
Talk normal.
Talk normal at me, man.
Once in St. Petersburg, he wrote in his diary that he thought it was far superior to Paris. He actually favored it. And he spent most of his time reading and in isolation, kind of a nerd.
Yeah, so his take on what city is better is total trash.
You know, it's not a reliable source. Yeah. He didn't really get out.
They did start beheading each other eventually in Paris, so.
Fair enough.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. 1782, Adams returned to France and was recalled by his dad to become his own secretary. September 1783, a final peace agreement was signed and recognized the United States as its own independent nation. The Adams go to London, and Quincy takes in British culture. They meet up with Thomas Jefferson in 1784 in France.
What culture you pick up in Britain?
I'm just establishing my guy is a world traveler.
Oh,
he's hitting
up
all these different spots.
You're doing a great job. You're doing a great job of establishing a timeline and a bulletin board of pins in a map, right? But it's like he's taking in the British culture. Neat.
How different is that than
the American culture
at that point in time? Yeah, I mean, a little probably, but
slight.
Yeah,
slight at best.
The Adams.
He is a big theater guy. I think he learns to love theater.
Okay.
In England.
Yeah.
Because he loves Shakespeare.
Can't imagine there was a great theater tradition in the Americas at that point.
Absolutely was not.
Wait, you said this was when John Adams was the ambassador?
So this is 1783. Final peace agreement is signed that recognizes the U.S. and, you know, the war is over.
Yeah, okay.
They then meet up with TJ in 1784 in France. And this is kind of where Quincy gets into good favor with TJ. They become boys.
Okay. Well, TJ does like him young.
Mm.
Sally Hemings was 14 when he started drilling her.
Damn.
Also, apparently, maybe his dad did the same thing and they could have possibly been related.
What? To who?
That's just speculation.
John Adams?
No, not Adams. Jefferson. Jefferson and his dad.
Oh.
With the whole slave stuff.
Oh, so Jefferson could have been related to Sally Hemings?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, boy.
Yikes.
Because he did not. It's not like Jefferson was the first in his family to do it.
No. So. It's pretty common. There was a funny letter. Well, it's not really funny. Funny's not probably not the way to put it. But with the Sally Hemings thing.
The Founding Fathers were complicated, okay, guys?
Complicated people.
What's complicated? He fucked his slaves.
Yeah.
It wasn't complicated.
Well,
he just took advantage of someone he saw as property.
Child
okay,
slaves.
I'm talking about as the general idea of the Founding Fathers.
Oh, yeah. I mean, like, anyone that lauds them as these, like, perfect beings is wrong.
No, but they're also not just, like, terrible human beings. They accomplished a lot. And
I mean, I think it says a lot that, you know, imperfect people can make something apart from themselves.
They also knew
glorious.
At the time it was wrong.
Yeah.
They knew the country would not survive if it wasn't for slavery. They knew it had to be built, and eventually they would revisit the topic later on.
Anyway, what I was going to say was that Abigail Adams wrote Jefferson a letter because Jefferson had Sally Hemings, and then I think Sally was taking care of his daughter or something like that. His daughter was older than Sally, or was younger than Sally, sorry. And Abigail Adams wrote him a letter. They stopped over in England, and the Adams just took care of them. And she wrote Thomas Jefferson a letter, and be like, they're here, and they're doing well, but I got to say, man, your slave is, like, less mature than your daughter. She's more to take care of as a child than your daughter. So it was, like, very immature 14-year-old, very childlike.
That you are banging.
And no, he started banging her on that trip.
On the trip, yeah.
He got the letter and was like, God damn, boats can't move fast enough.
Also, probably the time to mention that both John Adams and Quincy, no slaves.
Yeah, and I don't know about Quincy, but John Adams was pretty adamantly anti-slavery.
Quincy becomes a pretty big abolitionist.
After he was president?
No, the whole time, but okay. He doesn't really get anything done when he's president, and we'll find out why. Perhaps there might have been some obstacles in the way.
Moles.
More people.
More people.
Yeah, fuck it, Jake. It was moles.
That's what I thought. So I was right.
No.
Okay, I can feel better now. Thanks, guys. All right, I'm out. See you
1785, later. Quincy decides to go back to the U.S. and finish his studies. He enters Harvard in 1786, studies law, and graduates second in his class. He opens his own law practice at 23, a year after his dad becomes vice president. And by his own admission, our guy John Quincy, kind of a slob.
Really?
Not the best dressed dude.
He calls himself out on this?
Yeah, he always talks that. He says the words in his diary, careless of dress.
Yeah, he's just like, I'm not ironing a shirt.
You know, he's, again, like, he's not a Virginian. He's not a South Carolinian. He's just some Boston slob.
He would sometimes go to church barefoot.
Okay.
That's a lot.
That's fucking, the only person that does that is named River. Like, you know what I mean?
Is he not, fucking Tom Sawyer? Good yeah. Lord.
It's like, oh, man, my chacos, they broke on the way here, so I just did it all natural.
Also, for such a global man, not great with people.
That doesn't surprise me. Just because you travel a lot doesn't mean you're great at talking to people. It you could travel be. And not talk to anyone.
He's
but
also
fucking
a highly intelligent person.
Yeah, you
maybe on the spectrum.
You should be able to talk to anybody if you travel a lot because you have a lot of things to talk about.
What if you don't like talking to people? What if you just want to look at shit?
He wasn't one for small talk, and he There's lacked social graces, okay?
Okay. Mm.
In fact, a British diplomat wrote that Adams had a vinegar aspect and sat in frivolous assemblies like a bulldog amongst spaniels.
What does that even mean?
I was about to say, like,
pouting, looking grumpy.
Or just like, rah, 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 rah.
Have you seen Quincy, too, with his facial hair?
Oh, yeah. But see, the spaniels, though, are that makes sense for a government situation, right? Because they're all just like, yeah, 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 yeah. So it was a bulldog just sitting there like, God damn, these fucking spaniels. I hate everyone.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess so.
And then also, he probably had hip dysplasia, like most bulldogs.
He does look, I'm looking at his picture right now. He does look like a man with hip dysplasia.
He was a giant theater fan, like I said, in 1792. He was a founding member of a citizens committee that sought to repeal a law that banned theatrical entertainment in Massachusetts.
What?
They banned the theater in Massachusetts?
Yeah.
So hold on.
Why?
If I can get this straight, what year was that?
1792. So he repealed the law.
Right. So what I'm saying is that at some point, probably maybe at that point, right before he repealed it, but certainly right at some point before that, theater was illegal in Massachusetts. But owning slaves was legal.
Yeah.
So if you put on Guys and Dolls, straight to jail. That imprison another human being and make them work for free and rape them, as long as you own them, that's fine. That's
nothing
cool.
Sounds, nothing tracks harder for Boston than that. It's like, fucking theater nerds, fuck go, you.
Fucking get off the stage. Go home, you fucking queer. Go home and fuck a slave like a man.
Fucking homos doing Shakespeare over here. Yeah, so he became an original shareholder of the Boston's Federal Street Theater.
Street theater? What is it, mimes and jugglers? What, doesn't sound like Shakespeare to me. Yeah. Someone just like reading sonnets on a street corner?
I think it's just a venue.
Okay.
The street theater is actually just a dude with three cards. You got to pick one. This is like the guy that picks, or the three cups, and there's a bean under one.
It sounds like what someone yells when they're getting moved by the NYPD. They're like, it's street theater, man, come on! They're like, get the fuck out of here.
In 1794, Adams began a career in international diplomacy, serving first as U.S. ambassador to the Netherlands. He went on to serve as ambassador to Portugal, Prussia, Russia, and Great Britain.
I mean, that's legit. It's a lot of different ambassadorships.
As America's foreign minister to Russia, Adams would wake up at 5 a.m., and he was the OG cold plunge guy.
Oh, really?
He would have an ice bath every morning.
You know, when I was younger, I used to do like an icy shower in the morning. I used to take a really cold shower to wake up.
Why?
Why
would you torture yourself?
Because I thought it felt kind of cool. Like, it was like, oh, I'm awake now. And then as soon as I think I got even like 4 days into that, I was like, this fucking sucks.
So you didn't used to do that. You did it three times.
When I was a kid.
You used to do that. Makes it sound like you did it for months, years.
Three days.
Three times. Yeah.
Yeah, sure. It's a good story. I thought it was important. I thought it was really important to add. I think it's a psycho move.
It is a psycho move.
But yeah. I think it's pretty cool that this has become more and more popular in this day and age.
What
and
if they find out it's like
Quincy actually did this back in the day?
Yo, I guarantee they're going to find out like once these like 67-year-old dudes start doing the cold plunges and hopping in, they're all going to start having heart attacks from the shock.
You think so?
Oh, dude, for sure.
Is it that bad? I mean, no. I have for a scavenger hunt once, I swam in a pond in January.
So?
Like it was fucking below freezing.
Missouri?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah, not here.
I was like, here.
It was in college.
Okay. Yeah.
We threw a sex doll in and I went to rescue it as a lifeguard.
That's good. It can float.
Yeah. What's up? She didn't need rescuing. Honestly, it was pretty stupid.
Yeah. She is.
She's fine. She
floats
swim.
Herself. Yeah.
But I did it. And it was pretty fucking cold. I think I've swam in like water in like January ice, like middle of winter, one or two times.
The coldest water I think I've ever been in is like 50 degree water.
Yeah, this was definitely colder than that.
Yeah, I've never been anything colder than that. Like, spring water is really about as cold as I want to get.
It's not fun.
68, that's fine.
Adams spent the winter of 1795 to 1796 in London, where he met his future wife.
What was her name?
Louisa. Catherine Johnson.
Louisa Catherine Johnson, got it.
The second daughter of American merchant Joshua Johnson. They did not immediately take to one another.
Well, that's her problem.
Is it?
In the 1700s? Yeah, sure.
Yeah, it is.
Both had previously expressed interest in other potential partners.
Okay. Oh, actually, that was a scene in John Adams in the show. Quincy was just banging some poor chick, I think.
Mm-hmm. And it was like the love of his life.
Yep. And John Adams is like, you can't, nah, you mm-hmm. have a chance to be somebody. You cannot be banging poor
You can't
people.
Be with a poor.
Yeah.
And he regretted that kind of the rest of his life.
Well.
Because he ends up with this girl.
Guess what, buddy? You marry a poor, then your writings that are so important, the most important in human history, they're fucking useless.
I'm going to go out on a limb and say they never were or never will be the most important in human history.
No, I think they're top five.
Why?
I think it's everything Jesus wrote in the Bible.
You don't believe it. I don't care what you list. You don't believe this. Just continue, Dan. You're fine.
Yes, because Jesus notoriously wrote so much.
Yeah.
Always with a quill and piece of
parchment.
Parchment. Yeah.
Papyrus.
That's why it says the Bible by Jesus.
Yeah.
New Testament by Jesus Christ.
Oh, that'd be a funny thing to go stamp on Bibles.
That would be funny. Oh, dude, if you did like a about the author.
Or you just like signed every Bible Jesus Christ.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Oh, like you do funny. Like, oh, it's a first edition signed. Jesus, he signed it.
Whoa. Then you just get struck by lightning and hit by a car.
Yeah. But I want like an about the author with a picture of Jesus like looking off into the distance.
Yeah.
Just like. Jesus Christ,
Jesus,
Son of God.
Jesus of Nazareth was born to.
Yeah, born to Mary, a virgin at the time.
They ultimately got together because of the prestige of both families and kind of grew fond of each other's talents. Adams in particular.
I think it's the type of marriage where you're just like, it could be worse.
Yeah. He liked Johnson's kind of knowledge of music and she sang a bunch. And
also,
he ultimately grew to hate that.
The singing?
The thing that he liked initially, he was just like, ah, I can't be in the room with her anymore.
Hear me out on Miss Poor Girl or whatever. So, but he still likes that she's smart and shit like that. Well-educated.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay, hear me out. He's not in love with Poor Girl. He's infatuated with Poor Girl.
He likes fucking Poor Girl.
And he hasn't had a chance to live with Poor Girl. But when he like is making references about Latin, and she's like, I don't know nothing about that, mister. Well, you could just slaughter in this all whenever you like.
You
Poor
know
girl
what?
Was in America, though.
But it's fine. It's there.
It's all the same. Yeah.
It's, at this point, it's all the same.
And this girl is technically American living in England.
Who?
Louisa.
Okay, yeah. But I'm just saying, like, eventually, that's just low class. Like, you know, she's going to be like, well, I might slop for dinner again. And then he's going to be like, oh, my God. Oh, my God, my dad was right. Oh, yeah. My God.
Oh, man, rocks for breakfast again, huh?
Yeah. Like, well, check it out, too. Quincy kind of gets duped here because maybe she's not so wealthy.
Oh.
Maybe she's also a poor girl.
Oh, no. How tragic for him.
Maybe she's kind of playing him.
I also don't think he... Some dudes just want a cheerleader. Some mm-hmm. dudes don't care about the conversation with their wife.
Yeah. It's well, like, Big John and Abigail disapproved of his decision to marry a woman who grew up in England, but he informed his parents that he would not reconsider his decision. Adams initially wanted to delay the wedding until he returned to the United States, but they married in the All Hallows by the Tower on July 26, 1797. Shortly after the wedding, Joshua Johnson, her father, fled England to escape his creditors.
Oh, no.
And Adams did not receive the dowry that Johnson had promised him.
Oh, but he's already married?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, so we didn't even get a
You
got
to get that dowry before you sign those papes.
Can you believe we got married in a time post-dowry?
Regret it every day.
I could have had at least one cow. Like something.
I know. You'd be into that.
I would be.
A cow in your backyard.
Oh, my God,
just
dude.
Hanging out.
Just if I had one dairy cow in my backyard, can you imagine? I would be making so much shit.
Oh, yeah.
Be making ice cream, butter. Every time I showed up at your place, I'd have just dairy products for you.
After this, they go back to Prussia, and then we're going to jump ahead to 1802, when Adams was elected to the Massachusetts Senate. He tried running for the U.S. House of Representatives in November, but lost.
Hmm.
Luckily for Quincy, the Massachusetts legislator elected him to the U.S. Senate soon after.
Yeah, so I think at that point, Senate races were not statewide popular vote.
Oh, they're just picking people?
The legislature
was picking people. Yeah.
Check it out. For like most of his career, the popular vote doesn't really mean anything.
Yeah. Probably right.
So he holds it down for 5 years. 6 years later, President Madison appointed him minister to Russia. After that, he became Secretary of State under President James Monroe. In fact, he was one of the most accomplished Secretary of States for his era, and maybe of all time. He actually shaped the Monroe Doctrine.
Oh, shit.
It was him.
Whoa.
Monroe kind of just stamped his name on it, but this was Quincy's little baby.
I mean, you know, that's like giving... Look, we all know Andy Reid, great offensive mind, mm-hmm. right? But a lot of his stuff at this point, it's the OCs doing it. Or like Nick Saban, great defensive mind, but like it was Kirby Smart crafting a lot of that type of stuff. You know what I mean? Like, it, because at some point, you're the CEO.
Yeah, you got to recognize talent.
You're not calling the plays.
Yeah.
Right.
You're assembling a super team.
I wonder how many secretaries of states have become president, actually.
That's a good question.
It's less than you think.
I would think you'd count it on one hand.
So Jefferson was one mm-hmm. as well.
It was Quincy. Pretty early on. It was like the springboard.
Yeah. Yeah. Six. Jefferson. Madison and Monroe. So, uh-huh. Yeah.
So, it was early like four on. In a row, yeah.
Holy shit. So, there hasn't been one since James Buchanan.
Okay. That sounds right.
It was Jefferson, Madison, Monroe, John Quincy Adams, and Van Buren.
Probably because of what Buchanan did. Buchanan really kind of threw that
on
fucking
Buchanan.
Yeah.
Nail in the coffin there.
Hold on. Was Clinton part of the Secretary of State curse? Wasn't a VP? Where there was a gap between Senate and everything. Like, I think Secretary of State.
Do you think so? Buchanan put the stink there, on it.
Yeah, Hillary Clinton had the Buchanan curse.
Who's the most recent one that's run? Clinton?
I think Hillary Clinton.
Yeah.
Who was the Secretary of State for Trump?
A lot of people and none of
them.
Oh,
yeah. They always kept. They kept. It was a
turnstile. I think the first one was Rex Tillerson, maybe.
Was that. Fuck. Was Scaramucci one, too?
No, he was. Press secretary.
That's right. He was a revolving door.
He had some generals, or wasn't the last one that Kelly or the Marine general, something
Megan
like that.
Megyn Kelly's husband?
No,
that one.
But anyway, he had a lot of secretaries of state. The other recent ones, though, under Bush, it was Colin Powell and Condoleezza Rice. Under Obama, it was Hillary Clinton and then John Kerry, who ran for president but was not Secretary of State until afterwards.
It's fine.
Yeah.
It's funny you bring up Trump, though, because we're about to get to a character that has a lot of Trump qualities. Or maybe Trump has a lot of his qualities.
Oh, yeah?
The original populist, of course.
Oh.
We'll get to it.
Emerson?
No. Just okay. Wait. Just wait. I'll feed you, baby boy.
Oh, the orator from Nebraska. William Jennings Bryan?
Nope.
Ah.
Quincy also negotiated the Adams-Onis Treaty, which allowed the U.S. to acquire Florida.
Hell yeah.
But check it out. The reason we were able to do this was because a man just kind of went YOLO, I'm taking it. And that man was Andrew Jackson.
Hell yeah.
Sounds about right.
Who becomes a really giant, like, fucking thorn in the side of Quincy.
So Quincy was the sixth president.
Mm-hmm.
When was he president again? Because Jackson was president in the
24 to 28. He was one term like his dad.
Quincy was?
Mm-hmm. And so you know who followed him?
Jackson, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know why?
Because he was like, fuck Quincy.
Yep. Yep. A lot of mudslinging. A lot of ugliness between Jackson and Quincy.
Love that.
Do you think he just called him some alliterative, mean nickname? It's like,
I've heard
Queasy
people
Quincy.
Yeah, like Jackson, Quincy. Jackson's a cowboy.
Quentin Quincy's
Quincy's
kid.
A nerd.
Queer so Quincy. Like,
Queer Quincy. I don't think.
Means weird back then.
Right.
Yeah, that works too.
That actually does work. Yeah, I mean, haven't they like, I know this is more modern here, but haven't they gone as far as to just call DeSantis gay in a roundabout way at this point? Hasn't he kind of said that now about DeSantis?
Who knows? Nothing tops calling Ted Cruz's wife ugly.
And then
him working the phones the next week.
Oh, boy.
You miss me with that.
In Texas, you can't be talking about a man's wife like that.
It's actually, you can.
I guess you can.
It turns out you can.
Do whatever you
and
want.
And the state will elect that man.
No, state
again.
Will. Happily.
If I was running against Ted Cruz, that's the only thing. That's the only ad I would run. Do you trust this man to have the balls to support you when he can't even support his fucking wife?
It is so funny, though, how everyone overreacts with Trump. And then it's just like there's so many parallels to Andrew Jackson. Except Andrew Jackson actually served.
Not just served, killed.
Yeah. He was a big-time figure. I mean, Battle of New Orleans, and we'll kind of...
Yeah, like...
We'll get to that.
Trump talks tough. Andrew Jackson backs every ounce of what he says up.
Yeah, Donald Trump's a giant coward.
Yeah, he's a pussy.
Yeah.
Andrew Jackson...
Jackson was kind of like
a
mix...
Bullet.
I know, he's a mix, though, between, like, Trump and maybe, like, Patton.
Yeah, I think
that's
good.
Fair.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think by the time Jackson died, he had something stupid, like a dozen bullets in his body.
Sounds right. When he was 12, during the American Revolution, he tried to fight a British officer, and that British officer slashed him in the face with a sword.
Mm-hmm. He almost got assassinated, but I think the gun jammed, and then he beat the
man with a
wannabe
cane.
Assassin with a cane.
Yeah.
How do you not just like die of lead poisoning?
We'll have to do an entire episode on Old Hickory, but
Andrew Jackson's a fucking
He's pretty
animal.
Prominent in this episode. So I think we'll cover him just enough.
I would love the ultimate presidential death matches, Jackson and Teddy Roosevelt in a cage to the death, both in the prime of their...
Yeah, that would actually be a fun little... what was that MTV show? Just Celebrity Death
Celebrity
Match.
Celebrity Death Match? Yeah, the claymation one? That was good.
I think Jackson wins just because he's meaner.
He is meaner.
like
Jackson's a cunt. there are stories about Jackson... meet him with I believe the Cherokee Nation. And
can't imagine that
one. He talked one-on-one with their leader, and the guy came out crying. Like, Jackson made this dude cry.
What do you say?
I think something along the lines of just, we're gonna wipe you out.
You're subhuman and we don't care. Yeah.
He's like, this is nothing to me. You are gum on my shoe.
Yeah.
But that's for a future Andrew Jackson episode.
Oh, boy. I mean, that's the type of thing. It's hard to cram into one. That guy is...
Jackson?
Yeah.
And it is... There are some, like, really, like, cool things that happen to Andrew Jackson, especially when he gets inaugurated.
Yeah.
Because...
He's the cheesiest inauguration ever.
No, he literally invites everyone to the White House for a party.
He throws a party. He has to sneak out of the house.
But people are there for days. They like shit on the floor. They're fucking each other. It's like a giant party.
No, he leaps.
He's the first like low class like person to get in the White House. He's the first pleb to ever win that office.
He also at one point in New Orleans after the War of 1812 just declares martial law and becomes king of New Orleans.
Mm-hmm.
That's cool.
And just jails anyone that like goes against him.
Yeah. I mean, that's how you get things done. You know, the things that we all hate about dictatorships, the one thing they do well is efficiency.
Mm-hmm. Kind of.
No.
Until they don't.
No. It's very efficient at making decisions.
I guess.
No, it's not. You guess. They are efficient at making... The decisions might not be efficient, but they are made efficiently.
All right, fair enough. Actually, if you want to see a great portrayal of Andrew Jackson, this is like such perfect casting that it could never be topped. There's a movie about the Battle of New Orleans. Man, I'm blanking on the title. It used to be... it's called The Buccaneer. Anyway, Andrew Jackson is played by Charlton Heston.
Oh, God. That's perfect.
Like... Isn't it, though?
Yeah.
And he plays it just as grumpy as you'd fucking expect.
Charlton Heston, man.
Back to Quincy, though.
Yeah.
He also worked with the English on a joint occupation deal of Oregon. Got a lot done as Secretary of State. He then ran for president in 1824. However, he was crushed by General Andrew Jackson in both the popular and electoral votes, but received more than William H. Crawford and Henry Clay. And since no candidate had a majority of electoral votes, the election was decided among the top three by the House of Representatives.
Mm. Which is still the law.
Clay, who favored a program similar to Adams, threw his critical support behind him. And that is how Quincy became president.
So that would still be the case if neither Trump or Biden got a majority of electoral votes.
If they didn't hit that magic number of like, what, 255 or whatever.
Then it goes to the House.
It goes to the House. Oh.
And this was the OG Stop the Steal.
Yeah.
Because Jackson was the most popular man in America at this point. Like, he crushed all three candidates. But I guess he just didn't get the
He was winning battles in the War of 1812. Was winning battles against Indians.
He had so many battles against Indians.
What?
He had so many battles against Indians.
Yeah, I mean, like...
Huge proponent of slavery.
This guy was everything America wanted at that point in time.
He was a cowboy.
Cowboy before there were cowboys.
Yeah, he was someone telling you, you know what? Everything that's pretty bad that we do that makes us greater, fuck it. I say we do it.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. I'm going to go out and say I don't care.
Lean into it.
I'm tired of acting like I don't want to do it.
Now, granted, he did a lot of actually like very impressive and good things as president and just in his life in general, but also, yeah. But that's a whole other episode. Anyway. Yeah.
So Quincy never actually gets much done while in office because a lot of guys that are kind of loyal to Jackson get elected into the Senate and House of Representatives and just kind of block anything he does.
Yeah.
So Quincy was all potential, never lived up to any of it. We're just kind of cover some fun little factoids I found about him while he was in office. He was an avid swimmer, and he had a daily fitness regimen where he hopped into the Potomac every morning. He actually almost drowns.
Yeah, it's a fucking river.
It moves. It's not a pond.
Not a good dude. Some guy.
3 months after he was sworn in to being president, by the way.
Some guy in St. Louis or near in Missouri just drowned because the part of the Mississippi River was frozen. And two of his four fucking corgis ran onto the ice. And he ran after them to get them. And all three of them drowned.
Oh, God, because did he fall into the water?
And yeah, and the Mississippi
moves,
and yeah. It's fucking big. Yeah,
so it's moving under the ice still.
Yeah,
yeah, that's crazy.
It's not frozen to the bottom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, even I don't know how ice works.
At 58 years old, Adams could reportedly swim the width of the Potomac within an hour. So he was a strong swimmer, but I think one day the current was a little too strong,
a little too much. He was tired.
Yeah,
but he made it. Didn't die. Quincy was also the first president to install a billiards table at the White House.
That's a bro move right there. That's very cool.
He noted in his diary that it was both a resource of exercise and amusement.
Okay, that's a reach on the first one.
Maybe like mental exercise.
Yeah, there's no exercise involved.
He liked to play billiards before bed.
Anything that's not exercise, then. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Although this was an unpopular take in America at this point.
Billiards, was it seen as like a
dirty gambling?
Yeah,
dirty gambling game.
That'd be like if you put in just like a big buck hunter. No,
at the White House,
it's like W. Just like, yeah, I gotta get my big buck hunter in before I go to bed every day.
Oh man, I'll never forget. Did you guys ever have that app? Oh, fuck, I don't remember the name of it, but there was an app run by Funny or Die where you could pitch jokes for money. To different like websites and stuff like that.
No.
And it was really cool. I made like maybe $20 on it ever. But it was just fun to like pitch jokes on it. It was mostly one-liners and shit. like a, if TFM had ever done it, it would be the type of thing where it's like you just pitch TFMs to it.
Yeah.
And one of it was like rejected bar games. And I was just like, I was proud of it. I don't even know if it's funny, but I still like it to this day. It was, what is it, Big Buck Hunter or just Buck Hunter?
Big Buck Hunter.
Big Buck Hunter.
Who could say?
Stray Dog Safari.
Stray Dog. It's just in Oklahoma.
Yeah, you just go around the city popping dogs.
No, it's the Russian Olympics.
Yeah, also that.
That's true, unfortunately.
I was like, and I didn't get a lot of votes. I was like, come on! Stray Dog Safari.
Now, Adams also had an exotic animal that he kept at the White House.
Oh, hell yeah.
In the East Room. I'm going to let you guess. What do you think he had? What do you think he had?
In the East Room?
He kept it in a bathtub.
He kept it in a bathtub.
Platypus.
That sounds right.
No.
Sea otter.
So
think more American.
More American? In a bathtub?
Oh, a beaver.
Mm-mm.
Damn. I'm out.
Bear.
He had a pet alligator.
Alligator, hell yeah, brother.
Go Gators.
Go Gators.
Fuck, you're wearing a Gators hat.
I know.
And he also, the reason behind having an alligator, it was both a gift from the Marquis de Lafayette, but also he just liked seeing his guests flee from terror.
Yeah. Sick. Hey, use the bathroom in the East Room.
Well, he liked fucking with people with the alligator.
Congress ain't letting you do anything. You got to pass the time somehow.
Yeah.
It's like raising a gator and using it to terrify people.
It's like literally I was inaugurated as a lame duck, so I'm going to just have fun and play pool.
Let's get to the elephant in the room.
Jake's lie. Yeah.
Mole people. How did John Quincy Adams become associated with the mole people theory?
I don't know, clearly.
Well, it's because he kind of was a proponent of this expedition to the Southern Oceans, led by former follower of Sims Jeremiah N. Reynolds, but only after Reynolds abandoned the Hollow Earth idea. So there is a connection to Hollow Earth through Reynolds.
Oh.
But he was out on it already?
He's like, you have to admit that's fucking stupid, and I will fund this expedition.
Quincy said that?
Yeah.
So Quincy had no part in wanting to go to the middle of the Earth for mole commerce.
No, he wanted to go to the poles.
Just to go? The age of exploration.
Thought it was useful, yeah.
I mean, it is. Quite honestly, the poles are the most useful positions as far as geopolitics are concerned.
He was interested in exploring the South Pole.
And, you know, we might find oil there one day.
We might find a lot of stuff there one day.
In fact, the phrase mole people didn't even come into existence until the 20th century.
So
he was not alive.
Where did this come from, then?
This was the internet. I believe it was a cracked video from, like, a decade ago.
That was just, like, he believed in mole people?
Uh-huh.
I probably saw it on a BuzzFeed list.
Yeah.
That got sourced.
You probably saw it on Cracked.
I probably did see it on Cracked. Man.
So, unfortunately, no, Quincy was not a believer in the mole people.
Hey, what's going to be fun, though, is we're not going to clip me admitting that I was
wrong.
We
also never posted it, I don't think.
We just bring it up on here a lot.
Oh, we never posted it?
We didn't post it on IG, but it is. I mean, you did say it on the show.
I did say it on the show, and I have it. There is a story of me saying that somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
There's a clip.
I get a lot of history stuff served to me on TikTok. And I watched one the other day about Prohibition, and this woman who was a history teacher went out of her way to have a little caption that said, no, the income tax is not from Prohibition.
Sometimes.
And I was like, huh. It probably wasn't because of us, but clearly a lot of people.
Maybe somebody heard it.
Yeah.
I mean, it got shared by Rob Riggle. So.
Oopsie daisy.
Sorry. Hey, you know, when I said
you
all that.
You made Rob Riggle look like a dick.
That's fine. He's a Kansas fan.
You know what? At the end of the day, I never thought I'd have that kind of influence. So
yeah, who knew?
I kind of get why people lie now.
It works. It's way better.
Yeah.
It gets more engagement.
That's on whose fault? Whose fault is that? It's not mine. It's not my fault.
It's the algorithms.
Yeah.
Unless you start doing it on purpose.
I would never be wrong on purpose. And I will say that
right.
Confidently.
Because here's the thing. Like any clip, if you see a clip of a person, like a news person or something, and that person's saying something that's crazy to you, and you're fucking furious, and you got to type underneath it, like, this is wrong, and you're wrong, and bad, and we believe this is bad, some variation of that, you've helped them, and you've helped spread the lie.
Well, the public being just in general a wasp nest that an algorithm can rattle. You can rattle.
And what happens is when you poke the wasp nest, all the wasps get angry, but then money falls out the bottom.
Yeah, they don't actually sting you. They just
money falls out. Yeah,
the wasps swear at you. They say you're a fucking idiot, the wasps. They never sting you, and you get paid more.
Gold coins fall out. It's like you're fucking Sonic the Hedgehog getting hit by something.
It's really counterintuitive, but like anytime you see that wasp nest, just Mario that shit. Just jump up and punch it because you're going to get some gold coins.
Can we get to what I found to be the funniest part of this episode?
Absolutely.
Yeah, for sure.
The presidential election of 1828. Not necessarily because of it, anything funny happening, but just kind of the parallels of shit don't change.
Love that. Always love a good shit don't change.
So, Quincy runs up against Andrew Jackson again. Gets ugly quick. Jackson, of course. Quincy goes after him for being dumb.
Yep.
Being a retard.
Yep.
Did he use the word?
More or less.
That's fantastic.
More or less.
Like he's just like, this guy has no education. Fucking backwoods.
I think if
redneck ass.
Goes after Jackson's wife.
Ooh.
Calls her a dirty black wench. Not because she's black, but because so Jackson ends up with his wife before she gets divorced from her ex-husband.
Ooh.
Jackson's a homewrecker.
Well, he wrecked thousands of homes.
Yeah, they were
tens, hundreds of thousands of homes.
Yeah.
Were wrecked by Andrew Jackson.
Quite the wigwam wrecker.
He only did one with his penis that we know of.
Yeah.
Here is the shit don't change moment. Andrew Jackson, what do you think he calls Quincy?
Gay.
No.
A bitch?
A sex trafficker.
Oh, no way.
God.
He calls for whores, basically.
Just explain it.
He claims while he was over gallivanting over in Europe and in Russia that he was constantly getting the sexual services from the Tsar and he was constantly moving women.
Interesting. So he was just like flipping prosties.
Mm-hmm.
It really doesn't change at all.
It never changes.
The sex trafficker accusation's been around forever.
I, for one, am fine with diminishing the importance of calling someone a pedophile or a sex trafficker. I don't think there's any negative downside to calling every single fucking person you don't like
the worst thing you can call them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A child raping.
Immediately escalating to
kidnapper.
11 on everything
you
do. It's the equivalent of I have a gun in every improv scene.
Yeah.
Like, you can't just escalate to this. There's nowhere left to go after you call someone a pederast fucking sex trafficker.
Well, you call that guy genocidal.
Check
That's
it
pretty
out.
Much it
it yeah. works. Jackson steamrolls him. It's not even close.
Well, that didn't work. He steamrolled him the first time.
I never thought about this, but if it's true that like a pedophile cabal runs the world, are they doing that bad of a job?
All things considered, no.
Would it separate myself from this take?
I'm gonna sit this one out. No, it's clearly a joke, but I'm saying like, what does it look like otherwise?
Yeah, I know. That's like when someone says, like, okay, let's say they are running the world. That's like the same thing as someone being like, I'm tired of men running the world. They made it so bad. Like, what do you mean you made it bad? This is like the best it's ever been.
Yeah, it's constantly improving.
Like, diseases are cured. Hunger's fucking fell off a cliff. Yeah. Poverty fell off a cliff. That all happened before we started electing women. What are you so mad about?
I'm actually distancing myself from Rob's take right now. I'm sticking with the cabal isn't that bad. Take.
We're gonna move on.
I think we should stick on it. The only thing I hate is any take where people are like, the world's awful right now. I know it's actually the best it's ever been.
I just think people want to be angry at something, so they invent bad guys.
I don't even think it's that. I think people just have this idea of self-importance where the time they live in
is either
the best or worst, or it can't be just fine. It can't just be fine.
I think
it can't be just in the middle.
Literally every generation thinks that the apocalypse is going to happen during their generation.
Yeah, no. I mean,
but that's...
Because how could anything exist?
A tale as old as time.
We're on the tail end of America, man. We're on the downswing of it, you know. Just shut the fuck up. You don't know. No one knows. That's the thing about it. No one knows.
Who are the next world powers?
America, Poland. China.
No, I heard China and Russia are in trouble.
They've been saying that for decades, too. Yeah. But
so Quincy almost gets a sense of relief after losing the election. In his own words, the 4 years were the most miserable of his life.
I buy that, minus the alligator hijinks.
And the pool.
And the pool. Well, no, what pool? There's no pool. He's swimming in the river.
Billiards.
Oh, the billiards. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, the billiards and the alligator. That's really it.
But Adams, being kind of, you know, he always fiend for some type of relevance and self-importance, couldn't just stay out of the limelight for too long. He ends up in the House again.
Hmm. Had to keep.
He's actually the only U.S. president to go back to the House of Representatives.
So he has been a senator, a secretary of state, president, congressman, ambassador.
He's been an ambassador. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He's done it all.
He's God damn.
He had a pretty accomplished life.
He kind of ran the gauntlet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Adams served 17 more years in the House of Representatives, where he started to hammer his biggest regret not doing as president, and that is slavery. In fact, he campaigned and was constantly censured for speaking out against slavery.
It's crazy they were censuring.
Well, you can't even say the word slave inside the House. There was a gag rule.
Oh, just don't even bring it up.
But he ended up getting the gag rule reversed because he argued, because he's a lawyer, that it was in a breach of the First Amendment, which
he
was right.
It absolutely is, yeah.
Sick.
So it wasn't because of people thinking that you should. It wasn't like any type of, like, you know, moment of clarity or morality. It's just like, oh no, this is actually against the Constitution.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a good scene in Amistad. I think it's in Amistad where they portray John C. Calhoun, who's like one of the biggest psychos in American history, the most pro-slavery person that you could possibly have. He was the guy who came up with what they call slavery. They basically call slavery a necessary evil. Mm-hmm. Something along those lines. And so to be like, I know.
Twitter back then.
What? Yeah, right. Everyone was like, I know it's bad, but it's like a necessary evil. And John Calhoun was like, fuck that shit. You know what? It's the opposite of that. It's a positive good. He literally coined the phrase, like, for slavery. It's a positive good.
So
we are domesticating these Africans.
When they get closer to civil war.
He's a fucking lunatic.
There was an argument the South would always make that, well, at least we treat our slaves well, and everyone you hire, these Irishmen, these Italians, they're getting paid dirt, and you're killing them.
Yeah.
Like, that was the South's argument, was that, oh, no, you're not doing it better. You're literally killing people.
They can leave.
Yeah.
Hmm.
I mean, once you get there, you're kind of stuck.
You got to really make a call. Are you going? Are you staying in New York? Are you going to Minnesota? What
again,
you
John, I'm not making this argument. I'm telling you, this is the pro-South argument before the Civil War.
I'm sure.
The scene in Amistad is Calhoun's just like looks like a psycho, and he's like, we'll fucking peace the fuck out if you try to take our slaves, basically. Like, just lunatic.
Speaking of the Amistad, John Quincy Adams represented the captives that petitioned for freedom before the Supreme Court. And so you never saw this movie. You're not aware of the Amistad.
I know. Movie.
So they overthrow the boat and they get to shore. And essentially it goes all the way to the Supreme Court, and he has to argue not off the merits that they're human beings, but that the people that bought them ain't got the receipts.
You got to play lawyer ball if you're going to be a lawyer.
That's the type of thing that drives me crazy when I see a lot of people complaining about, I'm trying to look up who played Bell, complaining about like certain arguments made in cases that are like popular and stuff like that. And it's like, dude, it's this. They're not making the case for Twitter. There's actual laws. I'm just like, do you want them to win, or do you want them to just like feel morally superior?
Yeah. Oh, dude, because you want them to win.
Believe that. Yeah. The job of a lawyer is to win.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, it's like when people, God, there's this case that's kind of popular right now. They did a documentary on it about this, you know, little person that was a child that got her age switched.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about? Have you heard about that one? Yeah. It's really fucked up. But people, like, they tried to get the dad for neglect and abuse, and the state couldn't do that. And they just dropped the charges on the mom after that. And people are like, why aren't they going after the mother? It's like, Do you know how many people would just lose their jobs if they wasted state money on a case they just lost and tried to retry it on a different person?
Right.
It's like, what do you think's happening? This isn't for morality here. It's like, the court is a venue.
Yeah.
That's it. You got to do the things you have to do there.
So he gets them off. They become free men.
Also, I was surprised he even needed the receipts argument because the transatlantic slave trade was like illegal.
Yeah.
The British were using a lot of effort and resources to fight it. You could not, importing slaves to the United States was illegal.
Dude, I'm sure it was illegal, but was it common practice? Was it socially acceptable? I mean, people would literally, there would be manhunters that would go up to the North and just get their slaves back. Even if they would take free men, people that were never slaves, and just bring them down. That's, I believe, 12 years of slavery.
No, I know, but I'm saying it was common, I guess, but I don't know what the volume was because it was fairly policed. Like, it was pretty decently policed.
Yeah, at this point, they know it's wrong, too.
Oh, yeah.
They know it's fucking wrong. Like,
we hear.
It's not like, oh, it was a different time. No, like, even then, they fucking knew.
Yeah. I think there is a quote from a slave owner, and I think they talk about it in Ken Burns' Civil War, in the documentary is where I heard it. There's a slave owner's like, I paraphrase, but he was like, I'd literally rather be in fucking hell than be one of those slaves out in that field.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. No, I mean, the idea that, like, one day someone just woke up and was like, wait a minute. We should treat these people nicely. Like, that...
People.
They were very well...
What do you mean by people?
Yeah, like that... I don't think anyone was like...
That's property right there.
Naive to what was happening.
Yeah.
And kind of a final note on John Adams. During a vote on February 21st, 1848, after giving a speech, anti-slavery speech, John Adams collapsed at his desk in front of the House. Fellow representatives who held the former president in high regard rushed to his aid. They swiftly relocated the ailing 80-year-old to the rotunda for a bit of fresh air. Then they moved to a more private location. He entered a coma, and he died just 2 days after a stroke. And weirdly, like we mentioned, actually a true story from last week, one of his pallbearers was one Abraham Lincoln.
Whoa. A young Abraham Lincoln who was a big fan of his. I'm glad he got to see us get, like, California and stuff, win the Mexican War.
Yeah.
Well, he was actually one of the proponents against the Mexican
War. I'm sure he was. Yeah. It was a very liberal position at that time. Very because they were afraid it was going to spread slavery. So they didn't want to add more land areas where you could have slaves.
Although he also was against, like, Thomas Paine and the revolutions in, like, England and France.
Against Thomas Paine, really
early on, like he would write under like a pseudonym and just start trashing Thomas Paine.
That's wild.
I mean, the revolution in France was fucking trash and chaos anyway, so that's not
his whole argument. Was if this continues, the cycles continue, it'll just spread into America, and that's the last thing they need.
Yeah,
But yeah, he was kind of a well versed, pretty chill dude, all things considered. Kind of a douche with what he thought of himself. Had a high regard for himself.
I mean, but to be fair, looking at his track record, like,
good resume.
It's hard not to feel that way.
Kind of unlikable, though.
Yeah.
If, like, not a good hang. Not the best hang.
I can see that. Honestly, I don't know if his, but, like, he got what he wanted with the slavery not spreading and the territories we got from Mexico, because they really didn't.
Yeah.
Like, Texas, we already had, so slaves were already there. That wasn't part of the Mexican-American War. What we got, mostly the West, like California, New Mexico, Arizona, stuff like that. There was a little slavery there, but, like, nothing of note.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing so notable that...
Yeah, it's not,
and they weren't states, so that was a big thing.
They were afraid of territories, right?
They were afraid of more slave representation coming into Congress and stuff like that.
I guess kind of the biggest accomplishment he made as... U.S. president was he built a lot of roads and canals. So he was trying to connect the continental
infrastructure
U.S.
I mean, connecting the U.S. is just still one of the most amazing things we've ever done as a country. But
you're never going to get props for doing the little things.
Yeah.
You know?
No, I mean, like, our interstate system's probably the greatest in the world.
Shall not. You know? Yeah.
Ike.
Ike.
Yeah. yeah, I guess, you know, I learned today that once again, I was wrong. That's what I learned.
It's a good lesson.
Yeah, I learned.
It takes a big man to admit that.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You know what? For everyone at home, I'm sorry I told you that John Quincy Adams.
But everybody else thought that, people. Too. I think it's because that cracked video. You that, make I something think, go viral, and all of a sudden, it's just facts.
Yeah. That's honestly, that's on me. I could have done my research. I didn't, because I wanted to believe the mole
people. I didn't fight back either. I heard that, too.
Yeah.
Yes,
sorry,
I
wanted to believe it. I really wanted that to be true.
Who's to say it's not?
You know, I didn't say
even
that.
Though mole people didn't come into the public discourse until the 1900s.
You know what I learned today? Honestly, that he basically wrote the Monroe Doctrine.
Yeah.
John Quincy Adams is one of the most influential people in U.S. foreign policy history.
Mm-hmm.
It's wild.
And he got Florida.
And he got Florida.
And he got Florida.
Kind of by the aid of Andrew Jackson, YOLO-ing.
Yeah.
It's like, we're going to take this.
But he is like...
Seminole country, we got that. We're
good to go. He is like... I'm trying to think of a dude who was like... he's like the Gus Malzahn to Gene Chizik's national championship.
Yes.
That's a good comparison.
Yeah. Yes.
Who's Hitler?
Andrew Jackson.
The electoral system. honestly, robbing Andrew Jackson of his rightful victory in 1824.
That was a stolen election. You want to yell about stolen elections.
That 1824 is pretty bad.
Oh, something I forgot to mention. Head of the Electoral College that year during the stolen election. Man from Kentucky. Andrew Jackson, Battle of New Orleans. Called out Kentuckians for being pussies.
Oh, really?
And that man did not forget.
That's really funny.
So, little common connection there. Maybe the reason it got flipped, I don't know. Maybe if he didn't talk shit about Kentucky.
Doesn't help.
Quincy never becomes president.
Yeah, it doesn't help.
But anyway, that's all I got today. Thanks for tuning in, ladies and gentlemen. Again, check out patreon.com/softcorehistory. Two additional episodes every week. And then softcorehistory.com for merch. Also, leave a 5-star review, please, and thank you. I will not drink until we hit 1,000 reviews on Apple. We are at 930, I believe, so I've got 70 more reviews.
Dude, you've gotten like 3 reviews since the last time you asked.
I know. So please, I would like to drink. I'd like to party. I'd like to have a good time. Please leave a 5-star review.
Seriously, if 75 of you leave a review right now, just leave a review.
And again, when we hit 1,000, I will get drunk on the show.
Like,
that's
extremely.
My first drink.
You will get very drunk on the show.
And I'll sleep in Joel's trailer.
When it's not your week, I assume. Or
it doesn't matter.
All right.
It doesn't matter. It's actually funny if it is my week. Yeah.
It should be. Tough.
Yeah.
Or at least for the Patreon. It'll be my Patreon week. I think that's probably a little bit better.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. You'll be drunk for 2 different shows. Yeah. That's perfect.
So I think me actually leading an episode would be more digestible behind the paywall. Anyway, for Rob Fox, Jake Goldman, I'm Dan Majester, and you just got soft served.